What's the role of mathematical and computational modeling in neuroscience?
I actually think that today the major role of models is to integrate structural data and activity data from different experimental sources. Because without having a mathematical model, we don't know how the structural data relate to the activity data. And also once we have such a model, simulating such a model is not enough, because the activity resulting from such a model may be as complex as the experimental data itself. So once we have a model, we also need mathematical theory and simplified versions of this model to create insight.
In your view, what are the challenges for teaching computational neuroscience in the world of today, and how can they be tackled?
So I see two challenges. One is that the mathematical tools we are using are becoming ever more advanced, but many students interested in computational neuroscience are lacking the mathematical background. So over time, we have to make sure that we are going to change this, so that for example, in biology, the basic mathematical education becomes more solid. And the second challenge that I see, and this is what the word classroom in the title of my talk mainly relates to, is that many models today are becoming complex, and there is a certain level of complexity one cannot overcome in building a model from scratch. For example, in a one-hour lecture or in the course of a PhD work. So we need to learn how to overcome this complexity barrier by building models from building blocks that were created by other scientists. And the digitalization of scientific workflows that is now happening in our field is a chance to advance this and enable the collaboration between many scientists in order that we can really have models as building blocks from which we can build larger ones with an increased explanatory power. And in my talk, I want to give an example of this.
Do you think the current coronavirus crisis will have some long-lasting impact on the way we do research and on the way we teach science? You've been talking about teaching as well. If so, could you please give us some examples of the impact on research and teaching?
The impact on science is, of course, that we cannot meet in person. I was planning a trip to Sao Paulo, for example, to the Neuromat, but this is probably not going to happen now. And this is also why we are having this video lecture now. But on the other hand, I think now we are becoming more used to having conferences by video and working together via video conferencing. And this may actually also be effective, because it avoids travel, and so it's better for the environment, and maybe also people can participate in meetings who would not be able to do this before because of budget constraints or time constraints. I think that this is working well if people already know each other from before, like the two of us, for getting first into contact and building up trust, I think that the personal meetings will still be very important. What we have seen in our institute is that also not having only a meeting, but also doing shared work online is becoming more usual. So for example, pair programming, two researchers working together on the same piece of code is now happening over video, and the quality is good enough that you can really do this for several hours. One very positive outcome that could come out of this is related to equal opportunity. So if we are building up these tools for e-learning or simulation software that you can access over the internet, then and you can just use a browser to access all this knowledge, then it doesn't matter what nationality you have or whether your school or your university is well equipped. You just have access to all these resources, and that could be a very good outcome if this can be realized.
Do you have any advices for young students and researchers who want to build a career in theoretical neuroscience, in computational neuroscience?
Maybe that one should not get lost in mathematics, even it is very beautiful, and still keep nature in view, and also to listen carefully to what the experienced scientists are saying and what kind of advice they are giving to you, but not necessarily to follow them, you know, because they are from the old days. and what I also think is that that in many research organizations, hypothesis-driven research is promoted a lot, and we are also doing this in our lectures. But actually, tool building, the creation of new instruments that allow you to discover new worlds where you couldn't have any hypothesis on before, maybe of equal importance.